So the aim of the project is to create a future ocean scenario that we might expect to see by about the end of this century. So as we're increasing the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere, about a third of that carbon dioxide is being absorbed by the ocean. And that increase in carbon dioxide in the ocean causes a chemical change in the ocean and basically makes it more acidic. And it's this process which is known as ocean acidification. So the aim of this experiment was to get some idea of how southern ocean communities, and in particular animals living on the seafloor, what sort of changes we might expect to see by the end of this century under a business as usual emission scenario, which means we kind of keep emitting more or less what we are now. We are expecting an atmospheric concentration of around 1,000 ppm. It's currently around 400. It's only a 0.4 pH change. It's actually a very big change in pH and would have very serious implications for a lot of marine life. For example, it can affect everything from the reproduction to the growth and development of many marine organisms. So we're looking at everything from the very, very small, so the microbial forms of life and bacteria, up to the macro, the larger invertebrates that you find on the seabed, things like starfish and sea anemones and those sorts of things. The experiment ran for an 8-week period, and the basic experimental design was specially designed chambers. So these were placed on the seabed and they are acidified to a level that we expect to see by about the end of this century. So roughly 2.5 times more acidic, or a 0.4 pH change. We had 4 chambers in total. 2 of those were acidified and 2 of those were controlled. So we can compare the acidified ones and see what kinds of changes might have occurred in those communities living in the chambers.
Every aspect of what we did with this project was something that we've not really come up against before. We were modifying and inventing ways to do this, and it was really gratifying when they worked, and it was really great to work with a team of people and use all their different skills to try and come up with a method to make sure that this all worked. We use dry suits, we use surface supply and an alga mask. So unlike the normal half mask that you'd be used to, this covers your entire face. It allows a space that we can have a microphone, so we have communications and earpieces. We can talk to the other diver and we can also talk to the surface. So underneath that dry suit, we've got a layer of thermals, then a fleece layer, then an even thicker fleece layer, and you're probably wearing 2 gloves, 2 pairs of socks. Each person just depends, a bit different. And we have 3-fingered gloves. You've got to learn how to manipulate things underwater with 3-fingered gloves on. A dive at the depths we were at, which is around about 12 to 14 metres, would last 50 minutes. Water's always about minus 1.8, and under the sea ice there in that bay, it doesn't vary over the year. When we first got there, there was very good visibility. The first dive that we did, we probably had 80 to 100 metres worth of visibility, which is remarkable anywhere in the world. And then slowly over the season, that decreases when you have the algal bloom. At the end of the season, it was much less than when we started, but it wasn't particularly dark. It can be if you've got a lot of snowfall, though we had plenty of wind, which tends to clear the snow off the ice. And so even though the ice was 2.2 metres thick, plenty of light down there. And we were visited many times by Weddell seals, and on one occasion in particular, we were visited by one that had a fish in its mouth, which is not something any of us had ever seen before. And it proceeded to eat the fish right in front of us in the dive hole, which was really special to see that.